he moved with compassion. I even raised up the dead. Once on a hillside, people were gathered, watching as Jesus.
Sweet to hold our newborn baby and feel the pride and the joy that he gives. Oh, but greater still the calm assurance we can face uncertain days because he lives,
and because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
If you can hear me from wherever you are, welcome. Yes, I'm actually at New Creation. I'm one of the crazy ones who, along with a few others, managed to come out, kind of test the waters a little bit. I'm just telling you, we made the right choice not to come to church this week, but to have our church online. Because while the main roads are pretty good, the neighborhoods are terrible, and it's going to take us a while to get it cleared here at New Creation. At some places, the drifts are up to 3 feet, so driving through that is a little challenging. And I am so grateful that you're here wherever you are, whether it's on your phone, whether it's on in your living room with your family, whether you're watching this sometime later. It doesn't matter. We're here and we're going to worship the Lord and we're going to spend some time in the book of Galatians. We've been working our way, starting with the book of Galatians. And I tell you, Paul really writes a beautiful letter. It's the letter that Martin Luther called his favorite book in the Bible. As a matter of fact, his wife, whose name was Katerina, he called Galatians his little Katerina, which was a way of saying, I really love this book. So we're going to begin by reading a passage from Galatians. It's a long passage. So wherever you are, if you want to open your Bible, and we're going to be reading from Galatians chapter 1, 11 to 24. So quite a few verses. And I'm going to be reading from the New Living Translation. But I always like it when people are looking at different translations. But here we go. Here's Paul, and I believe that Scripture is God-breathed, which means, yeah, Paul is writing to a very specific group of people for a very specific time. But because this is Holy Spirit-inspired, I believe we can read this as if Paul is writing it to us, because he is. Here's what he says. Dear brothers and sisters, I want you to understand that the gospel message I preach is not based on mere human reasoning. I received my message from no human source, and no one taught me. Instead, I received it by direct revelation from Jesus Christ. You know what I was like when I followed the Jewish religion, how I violently persecuted God's church. I did my best to destroy it. I was far ahead of my fellow Jews in my zeal for the traditions of my ancestors. But even before I was born, God chose me and called me by his marvelous grace. Then it pleased him to reveal his son to me so that I would proclaim the good news about Jesus to the Gentiles. Now, when this happened, I did not rush out to consult with any human being, nor did I go to Jerusalem to consult with those who were apostles before I was. Instead, I went away into Arabia, and later I returned to the city of Damascus. Then, 3 years later, I went to Jerusalem to get to know Peter, and I stayed with him for 15 days. The only other apostle I met at that time was James, the Lord's brother. I declare before God that what I am writing to you is not a lie. After that visit, I went north into the provinces of Syria and Cilicia, and still the churches in Christ that are in Judea didn't know me personally. All they knew was that people were saying, the one who used to persecute us is now preaching the very faith he tried to destroy. And they praised God because of me. Well, let's pray. And let's ask God to speak to our hearts. Father God, I thank you so much for the fact that you called the Apostle Paul, that you chose him before the world even began, that you had a plan for him, because that also shows us that you have a plan for us, that you have chosen us before the foundation of the world. Father, I pray that you will help us to take these words to heart, that we can walk away with what it means to be called by you and understand that you never get it wrong when you call us. Let's pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I spent this last week at pastors' meetings in Topeka. And there's nothing like hanging out with a bunch of pastors and conference leaders to make one feel like an imposter. I'm going to confess something today. And maybe it's good that most of you are in your homes. Hardly a day goes by as a pastor that I don't feel a little like an imposter. They call it the imposter syndrome. You won't find that diagnosis in Scripture, the imposter syndrome, that is, but it runs all through the Bible. It's a feeling one has of being an unqualified fraud. I mean, who am I to be called by you, God? Are you so desperate, Lord, that you called me? I mean, I'm not trained. I'm not typical. And my resume is weak. Have you ever felt like that? I'm the wrong choice. Have you ever felt that way? I'm the wrong choice. And how soon before the people figure that out? That's the imposter syndrome. For sure, Jacob, he literally wrestled with it. And Moses argued with a burning bush because of it. And Elijah, he had it bad, wanting to die because of it. The so-called major prophets, like Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Ezekiel, they all struggled with it. It's a feeling of not being up to the task. That's how I often feel. Often. 1,000 times I've questioned why God would call me back into ministry. I don't look the part. I don't always sound the part. I don't have an MDiv from the seminary. I don't even have a suit that fits at the moment. I'm a recovering alcoholic who struggles sometimes with anxiety and depression. So upon occasion, a wicked voice whispers in my ear, "You're an imposter, Mike. You're a fraud." I know that voice does not come from me, but rather from the accuser. I know that because the book that I call Scripture tells me that Christ lives in me, and I believe it. And his voice tells me, "I called you before the world began. You need no other credentials but that." Did you know that in our congregation that we are blessed with 7 current and former pastors? All of them are gifted with a pastor's heart, and we all still wrestle with those voices. Well, the book of Galatians tells me that the Apostle Paul wrestled with those voices, with the added insult of individuals challenging his calling as an apostle. And Paul counters those false voices with a reminder of where his calling comes from, where his identity comes from, and where his authority comes from. Not from people, not from some university or some conference or some board of trustees, not even from the other apostles. Paul's calling begins and ends with Jesus Christ. That's true of your calling, too. That's true of mine. Period. Period. So Paul writes, clearly defending himself from these accusing voices who've come back to Galatia to undo much of what he's done. And he writes, "Dear brothers and sisters, I want you to understand that the gospel message I preach is not based on mere human reasoning. I received my message from no human source, and no one taught me. Instead, I received it by direct revelation from Jesus Christ." Now, have you ever noticed that God has strange tastes when it comes to calling people? He once called a pagan idol worshiper in Mesopotamia named Abram, along with his wife Sarai, to launch a people out of which would come the deliverer. He also called a murderer named Moses to lead an unruly band of slaves into freedom. He called a womanizer and a murderer named David to actually unite this hodgepodge of tribes into a cohesive nation. And then there's Paul. And Paul was a religious zealot in the worst way. And God said, "That's my guy. That's my guy." Now understand this, God always calls the right person. He doesn't screw up on his callings. If God picks someone, it's the right someone. And God has picked you. And he's picked me. How do I know? Well, because we're here listening. Some are here in this room. Some are watching on their phones. Some are watching on their TV. And that's not an accident. You see, God has a plan. And I think that's where the power of personal testimony comes in. It's an opportunity to show God at work through questionable people to achieve unquestionable results. And God ultimately gets the glory. So Paul begins a brief summary of his testimony. And he writes this: "You know what I was like when I followed the Jewish religion, how I violently persecuted God's church." Oh yeah, we know, Paul. You were a monster. And he goes on, "I did my best to destroy it. I was far ahead of my fellow Jews in my zeal for the traditions of my ancestors." I mean, Paul was literally on track to rise to the top of his field. In his case, that rise would probably have led him to the Jewish Sanhedrin, such as his teacher, Gamaliel, or Gamaliel, or also his teacher's teacher, the great Hillel. He would have probably risen to levels that would have made his teachers and his parents and his friends proud. And he would have earned multiple university degrees, earned big honorariums on the speaking circuit. He would have lived in wealth and comfort and even some regional fame. But God had other plans for Paul. He had a calling. Paul goes on, "But even before I was born, God chose me and called me by his marvelous grace." We know the story. On his way to Damascus to extradite Jewish Christians back to Jerusalem to be tried and likely executed, Jesus met him on the road. You know the story really well, and it's in the book of Acts. An atomic-like beam of light knocked Saul off of his horse. And the men with him, they saw a light, but Saul saw Jesus. And the other men, they heard a noise of some sort, but Saul heard Jesus. God picked Saul of Tarsus for a marvelous work and a message that would seem like foolishness to most. God picked Paul for a work that would ultimately have him flogged, stoned several times, shipwrecked, mocked constantly, and belittled. He would live through starvation, years of imprisonment. His eyesight would suffer. We're actually told that he was bald. He lost his hair over this. And in 64 AD, he would have his head chopped off in a prison in Rome. He would go to his grave unsure of his own legacy and yet consider everything to have been worth it just for the surpassing knowledge and relationship with Jesus. In the end, all that mattered to him was Jesus. So when God calls us, he never does so for the sake of our comfort, that's for sure. He never, ever calls us for our purposes, but always for his own purposes and for his own glory. Never for our convenience, but always for our good. Imagine for a moment, though, if you will, if Paul had rejected God's call, what might his life have looked like? Had he rejected the call, he likely would have worked his way up the ranks of the Sanhedrin. He would have been honored by colleagues and subordinates. And I think that his natural talent and debate skills, and not to mention his outrageous ambition, likely would have pushed him into the actual headship of the Sanhedrin. He would have, as the saying goes, it all. And then, in 70 AD, Paul would have witnessed the Romans lay siege on Jerusalem. He would likely have been forced to watch the temple and stood it as it burned in front of him while he and all the other Sanhedrin council members writhed outside the city on Roman crosses. Paul could not see such a future, but God could. So Paul writes, "But even before I was born, God chose me and called me by his marvelous grace." Indeed, actually, Paul had more grace than he even knew. So when God called Saul of Tarsus, God upset his entire world, demolishing his ambition. Everything that Saul believed in, everything that he had zealously held on to, came crashing down. The law, the prophets, the traditions, everything was about to change and look different at the feet of God's grace. And this radical call, this new covenant alone might have destroyed a lesser man. So God picked the right guy. So what did Paul do in the face of such a radical, life-altering call? Did he call some former professors? Did he look for answers online? No. He prayed. And he fasted. Paul gives us only a sketchy hint of what he did after this radical call. But we can imagine it. He writes, "When this happened, when he had this amazing experience, I did not rush out to consult with any human being." I mean, he didn't run to the nearest religion department or the nearest university. "Nor did I go up to Jerusalem to consult with those who were apostles before I was." He didn't even call his pastor. Instead, he says, "I went away into Arabia, and later I returned to the city of Damascus." Now, here lies an intriguing question. Where specifically did Paul go? I love to ask this question because we don't know for sure. Paul says he went to Arabia. He went into the desert, possibly as long as 3 years. Now, of course, Arabia at the time of Paul was a big place, and it's a big place today. So where exactly in Arabia did the apostle Paul go to? Now, some have speculated that he maybe went to the kingdom of the Nabataeans, which is the ancestors of the Moabites and the site of Petra. Some have argued that he went to Mount Nebo, where Moses died, which actually gives the best view of the entire Middle East. But if God was calling Paul to preach a radical new covenant, a covenant of grace, doesn't it make sense that the premier scholar of the Old Covenant might go to the very site where the Old Covenant was given? You see, located in Arabia, to the southeast of the Dead Sea, lies Mount Sinai. Now, no one knows for sure where Paul went, but I like to think that it's not unthinkable that the zealous defender of the Mosaic Law would go to the very birthplace of that law to receive a new law, what Paul would call the law of grace and the Spirit. Every time God calls someone in Scripture, have you ever noticed where they go? They go to the wilderness. When individuals desperately seek God's calling, where do they often go? To the wilderness. Sometimes for 40 years, sometimes for 40 days. And sometimes they tend sheep. And sometimes they have to hide from a wicked king. Paul went, possibly for 3 years, praying, fasting, studying, and sitting at the feet of Jesus himself. Paul writes, "Then 3 years later, I went to Jerusalem to get to know Peter, and I stayed with him for 15 days. They would run into each other over and over and over again. The only other apostle I met at that time was James, the Lord's brother. I declare before God that what I am writing to you is not a lie." Now, some who hear me right now, may have heard God calling you. May I suggest something? May I suggest a wilderness season of prayer and fasting? Some of you are seeking God's call. You want a call. May I suggest a wilderness season of prayer and fasting? And some of you simply seek answers, clarification, and maybe even just a little help. May I also suggest a wilderness season of prayer and fasting? Now, I'm not suggesting that you take a hike down to Death Valley. I'm not even suggesting a camel ride up Mount Sinai, unless, of course, you're Paul Carpenter. But I am recommending a season of prayer and perhaps fasting. You see, the purpose of fasting is not to suffer, and it's certainly not to be on a diet. Rather, it's to give something up for a time in exchange for spiritual and mental clarity, for time with God, and for focus. It's a spiritual discipline, not in order to talk more with God, but rather to listen more from God. Now, think on this for a moment. If God can take a man such as Saul of Tarsus, stop him in his tracks, reroute him, redeem him, restore him, and set him on fire for Jesus and his gospel, he can certainly do the same for us. 2 Chronicles 7:14, I know you know this verse, tells us that if God's people who are called by his name, and that's us, would humble themselves and pray and seek God's face and turn from our wicked ways, whatever those wicked ways may be, God will not only hear us, but he will hear us and he will hear us, heal us, and he will heal our land. And that is the promise that we as a church are pressing ourselves into. That is the promise we are claiming these next 21 days. And the pastoral staff, the elders, and the prayer warriors, we're calling on New Creation Community to a great and mighty challenge. 21 days, beginning today, of prayer and even fasting. Now, we often think of fasting as giving up food. But what we want you to do is ask the Lord, what should I give up in this season? For some, it may be time on social media. For some, it may be a hobby that's become all-consuming. For some, it may be television. Maybe for some, it is food. But the purpose of it, again, is for clarity, for spiritual clarity, and then to replace it with time with God, not to speak more to God, but to listen. That's what we're calling our church to do. And every day for the next 21 days, at 6:30 a.m. and at 6:30 p.m., we invite you to come online on Zoom, and the link is right online there on our Facebook, on our website, and you will be able to come and join us. We had our first group at 6:30 this morning. We had 5 brave people, but it was mighty prayer. I believe that God is ready to hear our prayers if we humble ourselves, turn from our wicked ways. Whatever it is, let the Lord tell you if there's something that we need to repent from, as individuals or as a congregation. And if we pray, that he will heal us and he will heal our church. He'll heal our land. I believe he has something big planned for us. It's the beginning of a year, and that's often a time when people are ready for that. But I believe this is a good season to go into the wilderness and ask the Lord, what is my calling? What would you have me do? Pray with me. Father God, I pray that we can see, just as the Apostle Paul did, that we need no other credential other than the fact that you have called us. We all sometimes feel like an imposter. We all sometimes look at our lives and how we often fall short, and we see ourselves as an imposter. And we read in Scripture how we are righteous if we are in you, and yet we look at who we are and we have a hard time believing that, and we feel like an imposter. And yet you call us friends. Yet you call us sons. You call us daughters. You call us heirs with Jesus. So Lord, even as we sometimes have those thoughts of being an imposter, knowing that those are thoughts that are coming from the devil, help us to have faith that we are not an imposter because we've been called by you. And that is all that we need to know. So Father God, I pray that you will speak to every person within the sound of my voice, and that you will give each one a calling. You will give each one a purpose, and you will tell them with your Holy Spirit what it is you would have them do. For you, for your church. And Father God, I pray that you will give us the courage to step into the wilderness and to pray and to fast. Show us what it is you would have us fast from. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're calling this campaign Fast Forward. Because I like that. We're fasting to move forward. And we don't move forward. The Lord moves us forward. And so I just pray that you will take this call seriously. That you'll join us. Whenever you can, join us online and pray with us. If you can't, that's okay. You can pray wherever you are. And ask the Lord, what would you have me do? What is my call? Maybe you know your call, you just don't know how to go about achieving it. Say, Lord, what would you have me do with this call? And I pray also that we will have the courage to encourage each other with our testimonies at how God is at work in our lives. I'm so glad you came in. I'm so glad you joined me. I'm so glad you're staying inside and safe, unlike these crazy, crazy people that came in today. I do want to make sure you know a few announcements, one of which I've already told you, and that is we're starting 21 days of prayer and fasting. Fast forward 21 days of prayer and fasting. I encourage you to take it seriously. This is a wonderful opportunity. Take advantage of it. Also want to let you know, of course, that our new creation potluck will be rescheduled. Keep an eye open for when that will be. And also going to let you know that there's no Gorilla Faith today, but there will be, and no Coffee with the Pastor tomorrow either, because it's going to be minus 50 degrees wind chill tomorrow. Everybody stay inside. Use this as an excuse to sleep in, stay inside. And but we will be having Super Cow on Wednesday. We got three great classes. We have Super Jam with Susan Byers. And you're going to just have a wonderful time just praising God if you've ever wanted to praise God with the praise team. We're also going to have a new class taught by Pastor Dana about how to pray. How do we pray? You know, the disciples asked Jesus that question. They could have asked him anything, but the thing they asked was, Lord, teach us how to pray. So we're going to talk about that. Also, Howie Huntsman is going to be leading a class called Crafting Friendships. So if you are a crocheter, a knitter, if you do needlework, if you do any kind of craft, bring what you're doing together. We'll just bring everyone in a circle. We'll just enjoy being each other, in each other's company. Howie will lead a discussion. We'll also have some yarns and things for beginners. We can teach you how to do it. So come this Wednesday, 6:30. Pathfinders are also meeting that night. So come on out. Want to let you know one other thing. The work bee for tomorrow, as you might have guessed, has been postponed. We'll let you know when that's going to happen. And I think I got through it all. And so thank you all. Thank you so much for just tuning in. And I hope you have a wonderful Sabbath. Thank you again. Can I just pray one last blessing? Father God, I pray that you will keep everyone safe. Father God, I pray that you will keep everyone in their right mind, even as we get cabin fever. And Father God, I also pray that you will give us that courage to go out into the wilderness, proverbially, and to seek you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, everyone. Have a happy Sabbath.